Hi, I'm Johnny Engineer Turmel, and this is my speech to the Orlean voters in the provincial by-election, which did not make it to the Rogers TV program because I only got 90 seconds and my opponents all got a half an hour. So first we're going to take a look at my 90-second statement I was allowed to make before going on to the rest of what I have to say. Johnny Engineer Turmel, smartestmanonearth.ca, smartestman.ca for short. How dare I? Well, I have a degree in systems engineering, and I was the teaching assistant of Canada's only mathematics of gambling course at Carleton University for 4 years in the 70s. Google Great Canadian Gambler. I was also the professor at the Trump Taj Mahal in Atlantic City. Notice that Mr. Spock, science officer, also could figure out the winningest way to go. If Mr. Spock could at Computer Central all alone debug bad code to save a planet from the danger zone, no help he needed from the low-tech others with no clue. What Spock could do, the engineer says, I can do it too. My Spock Fix gives you online Bank of Canada account, a credit card without the interest on due amount. When all your payments go against the principal of debt, you're someday out of debt, as good can get. So this is my 100th election offering interest-free credit cards. Did the voters say no? Well, they didn't know. Look at this election here. The Advantage candidates get 120 minutes for four of them. We get 6 minutes for, well, my words are in the United Nations Millennium Declaration. I made them drop the charges against 4,000 marijuana cases. I bet I someday get 3 Nobel Prizes, and you should visit smartestman.ca if you want the rest of the stories that you're not going to get on Rogers TV. So that was my 90 seconds on Rogers, while my major opponents got a half an hour each on average. So how did that come about? Well, being my 100th election, I've been cheated probably more times than anybody else in history by the media. Now, you'll notice the backdrop, completely bland. The message I got from Rogers was, please refrain from wearing any campaign material. So they would have probably barred my hat, and they would have barred my Let's Disket Party button, and can't bring any props, no graphs, no props to use, no coins, no chips during the taping. So, as bland as they can make it, that's Rogers' brand. Bland brand. So, how did it happen that now half the guys get 2 hours to share and the other half get 6 minutes? How'd that come about? Well, when I started elections back in 1979, the Broadcast Act said that free time, political partisan broadcasting, not paid time, you could all buy as much as you could and want, but free time had to be shared on an equitable basis, qualitatively and quantitatively, to all rival parties and candidates. Got that? It had to be fair. So, in the past, in those elections, when media decided to not give me my fair share, I had this law to back me up when I complained. For instance, like this situation here, 8 candidates, 4 get more time, 4 get less. Well, back in the 1980s on CTV, they had 10 candidates, and they gave the first group 20 minutes and the second group 15. And I was in the group that got 15. So that means I got a minute less on average than the guys in the preferred group. So I complained. I said, put the commercial in the middle. They didn't do it. So I complained to the CRTC. I said not putting the commercial in the middle means it was not equitable quantitatively. It was qualitatively. Same time, same everything. And they said, well, we don't think that it was inequitable. It was too small, you know. And so I then went to court, federal court. And the judge said, nah, it looks pretty equitable to me. Then I took it to the Court of Appeal and the Supreme Court of Canada. I call it the case of the missing minute. So there is proof that it was inequitable, but they just said it wasn't inequitable enough for them to bother with. Fine, I complained to the top. But in 1986, the Ontario Court of Appeal decided that they would take away the right of political candidates to equitable treatment. The Vezina decision. They ordered that from now on, free time political broadcasts didn't have to be shared equitably. for all rival parties and candidates on a qualitatively and quantitatively fair basis. So, since then, lots of cheating, and there's nothing we can do. And when in 2000 and something, Rogers had me arrested for wearing my putting my party button on and taking me off the debate in Brantford, I complained to the CRTC, said they got no right to order me how my appearance is going to be and take me off the stage and make me miss my time. And so anyway, the CRTC said, no, the Vezina decision said they don't even have to give you any time, so they got a right to take you off for whatever reason they want. And the Supreme Court of Canada in the Turmel case, now don't forget, every time I got cheated, I dragged them into court. And here's like 15 different cases back in the 80s where I dragged them into court with the CRTC. And in the very last one in 2009, Docket 33319 at the Supreme Court of Canada, Turmel versus CRTC complaining about Rogers. They again said Rogers can exclude anybody they want. So that is why Rogers can give 2 hours to their preferred candidates, and they can give 6 minutes to the ones they don't prefer. And that is how the law has been corrupted by crooked courts. And I would love to pull Rogers' license if ever we came into power for having corrupted the airwaves with their unfair, undemocratic debates, okay? These are public airwaves, and they use them corruptly. And I would love to see the Rogers brand die for having been so crooked. But anyway, I can always pray and hope. So that is why this kind of unfair cheating goes on. So I had no choice but to say, look, I'm going to go and tell the people to come and watch me over here if they want to hear more of the story. So the only really interesting part at this stage is that when I talk about the Bank of Canada, it can be done anywhere. Any computer can become a bank of credits. And an example was back in 1993 when North York started issuing $25 hydropower gift certificates. Well, what a wonderful poker chip. You know, a $25 bill worth power that anybody in Ontario can use. So, now the most famous example for provincial was in the early 2000s, or 1980s, my mistake, where six provincial governments in Argentina started paying all their unemployed employees with provincial bonds, which they could use to pay power, hydro, taxes, medical expenses. And it became a new kind of currency, and it brought them out of depression. So we could do the same thing provincially. But I have a poem that I've written to explain the money problem, and it's 80-some verses, and it takes 6-7 minutes. And I'm going to read it to you now, because it's so crucial to why I've been involved in trying to abolish interest rates at the Bank of Canada for the past 40 years and 100 elections. I caught my poem is at smartestman.ca. How dare I? Well, I got the same education as Mr. Spock. You heard it in the previous clip. So, oh, Canada's debt national had much stability till 1974 starts exponentiality. Same in, I got graphs, by the way, I show in my debates, you know. Same in Ontario, Quebec, debt's doubling over time. Did debts all start to grow in big coincidence, sublime? The Bank of Canada once loaned to provinces and Fed without the interest that causes budgets to turn red. It financed major projects, made St. Lawrence Seaway B. TransCanada was highway funded, see the shining sea. Not only infrastructure, also paid for World War II. With interest-free cash, we almost nothing couldn't do. The only question then was how the tax should be assessed. For goods and services, a simple formula to test. For services, they levied tax at end of every year. For assets, tax to pay depreciation. Very clear. With taxes only for depreciation and repair, so easily affordable without the banker's share. But in 1974, Pierre Trudeau cut the feed, ruled no more interest-free loans for infrastructure need. All governments must borrow now new funds from private banks and raise new tax to pay new interest with bankers' thanks. Most people think banks work like piggy banks and they're getting someone else's savings. No. They work like casino banks. You're getting new chips. So we're told the government finance is only for the sage, too hard for Mr. Average at study to engage. But does it have to be well understood by only few? Or can the problem be explained for Mr. Average too? When you were little, did you ever dream of printing cash, of filling up your wallet with some money in a flash? Creating money accurately means to have the plates, the stamping of some paper into notes best demonstrates, or stamping metal into coins, or blips computerized into your bank account deposits, checks now authorized. So whether paper, metal, volts of electricity, to have the plates is printing money absolutely free. Now, if you printed it to spend, the others would bewail. They'd call it counterfeiting and then send you off to jail. But what if government would let you print it up to lend, with only what you can collect in interest to spend? If you could print and lend 1,000 out at 10%, you'd make 100 interest on printing that you lent. But if you could print up and lend 1,000,000 out, you'd get an extra $100,000 for your fee on debt. If government stops using its own plates and comes to you, 1 billion printed nets 100 million revenue, with everybody being taxed to pay you interest. Of all the scams in history, to have the plates is best. Though never spending, only lending, riches do await to all who with the plates become loan sharks to the state. And though to join the few who thusly profit you might dream, wake up to see we're all the victims of this greedy scheme. Though governments of old had treasury run money plates without the interest to middlemen at rip-off rates, most governments today to banking industry have lost control of money plates, so interest is now a cost. I'll pay my tax for army and police to handle strife. I'll pay my tax for doctors, nurses who protect my life. I'll pay my tax for all engaged repairing road and sewer. I'll pay my tax for social servants helping out the poor. I'll even pay my tax for bureaucrats with no regret. I only object to paying tax for interest on debt. I'll gladly pay my tax for people's time at useful toil. But taxing me for money's time will always make me boil. But worse, in 1968, Pierre Trudeau lifted cap on interest from 6% to 60. That's the rap. In 12 years, central bank rate rose to 22%. More tax to service greater debt at higher rates was spent. Percent of 30 was the rate at chartered banks we saw. Percent of 40 rate by private lenders under law. 1 million families evicted, their mortgage could not meet. With Pierre's high rate, death gambles putting foreclosed on the street. The reason foisted on them for such suffering high rates was interest will fight inflation, economic states. What idiot thinks raising costs can lower prices high? Yet fell for it they did, the biggest economic lie. We now see the unjustly cost that makes our tax inflate, and only interest is what we must eliminate. The best solution simply gets the plates back from the banks. Have Bank of Canada control for service charge and thanks. Pierre Trudeau is responsible for debts out of control, for lifting rate cap, ending interest-free loans, his role. Oh, Canada sure could have offered all a living swell, but Pierre in 1974 turned heaven into hell. While Justin could make loans again without the usury, can we expect but more bad fruit from father's crooked tree? An engineering dropout, beta boy, though blood and blue, like dad a silver spooner, wit for numbers, talents few. Our taxes disappear since over 40 years ago, for interest on Trudeau's debt we didn't have to owe. If we got back $2 trillion taxed since Pierre helped banks us fleece, reversing algorithm gets back 60 grand apiece. If Mr. Spock could at Computer Central all alone debug bad code to save a planet from the danger zone. No help he needed from the low-tech others with no clue. What Spock could do, the engineer says, I can do it too. My Spock fix gives you online Bank of Canada account. A credit card without the interest on due amount. When all your payments go against the principal of debt, you're someday out of debt, and that's as good can get. So, that's the ripoff. That's the Spock fix. It's a software fix. It can be all working by tomorrow. And that's why I call myself smartestman.ca, because I figured it out 40 years ago. And I've been trying for 40 years and offering in 100 elections to reprogram the Bank of Canada's computer to give everybody interest-free credits. So that is my analysis for the Orleans provincial by-election. And this is what the people did not hear on Rogers TV, where I only got 90 seconds compared to the half an hour my opponent got. So, see you next time.